Started here in just a minute. John, are we okay? Okay, the link is good. Good. So we're being joined by some other campuses, or one other camp, I don't know. It's great to see you guys again. Thanks for coming out on a Wednesday night. It is Wednesday night, right? Man, the snow and the Martin Luther's King Day threw me off, so yeah, good. It's great. If you were here last week, one of the things you will know is that we went through the passage in Romans chapter 9, just went verse by verse. Part of that was to try to show you how Romans 9 tries to answer the question, how is it that God can be called faithful to Israel when a whole bunch of people in Israel did not believe the gospel? And the answer was that there is an Israel within Israel. This Israel, he would say, is chosen by grace. And so this has been the case throughout the history of Israel. God chose Jacob, or God chose Isaac and not Ishmael. He chose Jacob and not Esau. And so there has been an elective line that God has chosen throughout Israel's history. This raises a bunch of questions for us. Wait, that's not fair. Paul actually interacts with that very question. And ultimately we're like, well, that if God's just determining stuff, then why does he still find fault? What about our free will and stuff? And the response that Paul gives to that in Romans 9 is, who are you, O man, to talk back to God? In other words, kind of stay in your lane. You don't criticize God for his compassion or criticize God for his elective purpose. You're not really qualified to do it. And then he explains some of the reasons why it is that he did that. So, and basically the answer is because he wants to display his character to all people, both in his judgment and in his grace. And that has been the history, that's part of the reason that we live in the world that we live in, is because God has determined that this world is supposed to display his glory. And so this doctrine of election, it displays the glory of God, according to the Apostle Paul. When it's talked about in the book of Ephesians, what I described last week is called, it's Ephesians chapter 1. We've been predestined, okay, according to him who works out all things in accordance with the counsel of his will, to the praise of his glorious grace. So the right view of predestination and election is to recognize that it is an act of grace on God's part. Not something that we should shake our fist at, but it's an act of grace on God's part. Now, last week, I went through the text, but what we're going to do here is we're going to take a step back, and I'm going to present the two big views about this subject, the doctrine of election. One of them is a view, that is held by people who are called Arminian. It's Arminian, not Armenian. An Arminian is a person from a certain part of the world. An Arminian is a theological kind of category, right? So an Arminian, and then the other term that's often used is Calvinist. I usually avoid giving these titles to people because if you've spent any time in theological discourse or just talking about theology, everybody's known a really rotten Calvinist before, right? Like sometimes they're really mean, you know? And lots of people have met Arminians who, you know, some are barely in the faith. They're so progressive in their thinking. So sometimes people have a bad opinion based upon the title. The titles aren't that important to me. What I want to show you is how does an Arminian understand the doctrine of election biblically? Like, what would their argument be? And then I want to interact with how a Calvinist views it. Again, my background here was I was a very, very committed Arminian. Most of the stuff that I'm going to argue for were for views that I held at one point quite stridently. I'm going to show you some critiques of Arminianism, and then I'm going to show you the Calvinists, and then some critiques of Calvinism, all right? Full cards on the table. You know by now that I currently consider myself a Calvinist, and so you should know that ahead of time. I hope if you're an Arminian and you're looking for someone to represent your view fairly, I hope you'll find it in what I say. I think you will. But we'll see. Let me pray, And then we're going to jump into this. Father, I'm thankful for your grace, and I'm thankful, Father, that you have shown it to the depths that we don't even recognize. And I'm thankful that salvation is all of grace. And because of that, we are forever held in your hand, and you say that you will keep us, even as we are commanded to be kept. So God, I pray that you will help us to reason through how those two things can be true at the same time, how it is that you expect us to be responsible and to respond with our will to you, and also how it is that you have ordained all things. So I pray that you help us to think well. I know that lots of us have a history with these sorts of doctrines, and I pray, Father, that if something's presented here that's a little bit different, help us to just think about it and to do what the Bereans did and compare it to what the scriptures have to say. Ultimately, Father, we are submissive to what you've written in your word, not what some theologian decided to put together at one point or another. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Before we do this, can I just make one real quick comment, though? One of the things that actually really does get under my skin, both when I was a really committed Arminian and now more as a Calvinist, is when people come along and say, well, I don't like the labels. I just believe the Bible. I just want the Bible. Now, I understand that. So do I. But you need to understand, an Arminian wants that too. Like an Arminian saying, no, this is what we think the Bible says about this subject. I've not met a lot of Arminians who are like, no, we have went to Jacob Arminius and we just follow his doctrinal viewpoints, you know, 1 to 10. I also don't know a ton of Calvinists who are like, yeah, whatever Calvin said, that's what I think. They're trying to evaluate whether what Calvin said is the way to summarize what the Bible teaches about election. So I know we don't like names and titles, but it's helpful in the discourse, right? It's helpful for me to talk about it by using this language. So here, in front of you, you guys got a piece of paper, right? 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 I'll take your lack of response as a no. Yes. Okay, you're free to respond. I've got four statements that I think summarize what an Arminian believes and why it is that they believe what they do. So here's number one. A loving God, or the loving God, wants everyone to be saved. So at the very beginning of an Arminian take on this subject, they start with the assumption that the Bible teaches that God wants everyone to be saved. Now, there's a couple passages in particular they point to, and I'm going to turn to them in just a second. But it's important, when I wrote the loving God down there, there's a reason I said loving God, because if you read people who are Arminian or speak to them, that is God's prime character trait, his love. His love is defined sometimes by some in more modern terms, but God is loving. And so whatever this doctrine is, it has to be loving, right? So the loving God wants everyone to be saved. So in your Bible, you got a Bible in front of you at all? Yes, please say yes. Oh, God bless you. You guys came to church and did the right thing. What I want you to do is to turn first to 2 Peter 3:9. Is that in the New Testament? Okay, wait. All right. I want to start from actually 2 Peter 3:1. The text that we're particularly interested in, the verse, okay, is in verse 3:9, and I'll read that. The Lord is not slow to fulfill his promise, as some count slowness, but is patient toward you, not wishing that any should perish, but that all should reach repentance. So it seems, on the face of it, outside, without reading context, at this point, we come to the conclusion, oh, see, God wants everyone to be saved. Okay? In fact, he's being patient. The judgment of the world, because he doesn't want any to perish. Any meaning anybody, anywhere, ever, at all. Let's go to the beginning. This passage, I'm not sure if it's saying exactly that, and I'll show you why. Verse 1, This is now the second letter I'm writing to you, beloved. In both of them, I'm stirring up your sincere mind by way of reminder that you should remember the predictions of the holy prophets and the commandment of the Lord and Savior through your apostles, knowing this first of all, that so the prediction was that scoffers will come in the last days with scoffing. That's what scoffers do. They scoff. Following their own sinful desires. Now, in what way will they scoff at God's people? They will say, verse 4, where is the promise of his coming? For ever since the fathers fell asleep, all things are continuing as they were from the beginning of creation. You guys believe that Jesus is going to return, and we've gone day after day after day after day after day after day after day, and he's not come back. So where is this return that you're talking? So, but that's a mocking. It's not like we're really interested in knowing when the return of Christ is happening. No, it's the fact that he hasn't shown up to this point. You guys are putting your faith in a really bad promise because he's not coming back. Verse 5, for they deliberately overlook this fact that the heavens existed long ago and the earth was formed out of water and through water. That's a reference to the creation account. Yes? Yes. By the word of God. Remember? Let there be. And by means of these, the world that then existed was deluged with water and perished. What's that a reference to? Noah, the flood, right? So God created out of water, and then he destroyed with the water. But by the same word, right, the same promise. So he's trying to get your mind back. Do you remember when Noah was on the earth and God had made a promise that he was going to judge all the nations with the flood? But by the same word, the same kind of promise, the heavens and earth that now exist are stored up for fire, being kept until the day of judgment and destruction of the ungodly. So we are, in other words, he says, in the same situation that Noah was in. Okay? And God has made the promise that Jesus is going to return. Now, you should take note here that what Jesus is coming to do when he returns is what? Judgment, right? I mean, that's what happened when the waters came up. But this time it's going to be through fire. So this is where some people in Christianity say, oh, well, that's the earth. The earth's going to burn up. Actually, it's a purifying. The fire in these days actually was often purifying. And that's, remember when the flood came, did it destroy the entire earth? Well, yes, but no. Like, the entire earth didn't just disappear, right? It's not like the whole earth became water and started dripping onto the moon. Like, it destroyed the things on the earth and purified them, yes? Well, in the same way, he's saying, look, the fire is going to come and it's going to, Jesus is going to return, he's going to bring fire and it's going to purify the earth. Which probably means that the earth is probably going to go through a purifying fire, but the earth itself, the one that you live on, is probably remaining. This is, which is precisely what God does with the resurrection body. God's not going to just get rid of your body, you know, burn it up, start again. He's actually going to take the body you have here and he's going to transform it, right? Now what happened with Jesus? He had a resurrection body that was transformed. It had likeness to what it was in the past, but now it's got a newness to it, similar. The earth will have a likeness to what it is now, which means you probably will go to New Zealand. To be honest with you, all of earth will meet New Zealand. All right, that's heaven. By the same word, the heavens and earth that now exist are stored up for fire, being kept until the day of judgment and destruction. And that's the point I really want you to hear there. Destruction of the ungodly. So there is a moment where God is going to come and he's going to destroy the ungodly. But do not overlook this fact. Verse 8. Who? Beloved. Okay, so who's he speaking to now? He's speaking to the church. Do not overlook this one fact, beloved, that with the Lord, one day is as 1,000 years and 1,000 years as one day. Meaning God doesn't count time like you and I do. The Lord is not slow to fulfill his promise, which was the accusation of the scoffers. The Lord is not slow to fulfill his promise as some, and probably that reference some is to the scoffers, as some count slowness, but is patient toward you. Who's you? You. The beloved, right? Is patient toward you, beloved. I'm inserting that for clarity. Not wishing that any should perish. Now, you got a decision to make here. Any of what? Anyone? Or any of you? Probably beloved. As most commentators go that way. Not wishing that any of the beloved should perish, but that all the beloved should reach repentance. So here's my point. When people cite passages when it comes to this debate about Arminian and Calvinism, you actually need to read the text themselves on both sides of it, and you need to decide, are those passages saying what those people claim that they're saying? I'm going to argue pretty strongly, actually, 2 Peter 3:9 does not argue that God wants to save everyone. It does argue that God wants to save his beloved. And that's why he's bearing with great patience and waiting till all of the beloved will come in, all the elect will come in, which is a phrase that you'll find in other parts of Scripture, just so you know, right? Now, you need to know, I think that God wants everyone to be saved. I do. And the reason I think it is if you go over to 1 Timothy chapter 2, you'll get what I think is a more compelling text, although it's not without its problems. So 1 Timothy, chapter 2. Did I say 2 Timothy? Sometimes I say things and I don't know what I said. So 1 Timothy chapter 2. First of all then, I urge that supplications, prayers, intercessions, and thanksgiving be made for all people. Now, you have to make a decision here about, is he saying that he wants you to pray for every single person in the world? That supplications and prayers should be made for all people. So you walk by somebody, pray for them. You walk by somebody else, you pray for them. Probably not. Because of what follows, for kings and all who are in high positions, that we may lead a peaceful and quiet life, godly and dignified in every way. So what he's saying is that you should not preclude or excuse kings and all those who are in high authority from your prayers, right? You should pray for all people, meaning all kinds of people. There shouldn't be a category of people, namely kings and those in high authority, who you don't pray for. Every category of person should be prayed for. Can we pray for every last person in the world? Sure. Which was a great idea. I just don't think that's exactly what he's saying here. I think he's saying, you should pray for all kinds of people, including kings and those who are in high position. Just as a total aside, and because I'm a preacher and I love Bible study, this has nothing to do with anything. Isn't it interesting that what he says, the reason we should pray for those in power and authority over us, Christians, is so that we might live a quiet life. So basically, they'll leave us alone. Okay, that's what you're supposed to pray for. Oh God, make Joe Biden leave us alone, right? Oh God, make Donald Trump leave us alone. J.B. Pritzker does not know we're here. It's in the Bible. For kings and all those who are in high positions, that we may lead a peaceful and quiet life, godly and dignified in every way. This is good. Probably this prayer for the kings and all those in authority. And it's pleasing in the sight of God our Savior, who desires, here we go, all people to be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. Now here's the thing. The reason I say it's difficult, because you have to make a decision at the point. You just said in the previous verses that it's probably not everyone, it's all kinds of people, right? He makes that clear by saying like kings and all those in authority. Now here's the next time he uses the word all. Is he using it as all kinds of people or all everybody everywhere? Do you understand the difference? The language here is it all without exception, everybody everywhere, all the folks, or is it all without distinction, which is what he said a second ago. Don't hive off kings and all those who are authority and keep them away from your prayers. So lots of commentators are going to say it's all without distinction. If you make that decision, then I just got to tell you, an Arminian doesn't really have a lot in the Bible to suggest that God wants to save everyone, because the two main texts that are used to try to argue that are both not talking about God saving all people everywhere, but all kinds of people. I actually think it's this one, as my view. So an Arminian can establish then, in my opinion, so you go back to the page that we were working with, the loving God wants everyone to be saved. So because God is loving, his desire is to save all the people, 1 Timothy 2:4. So is everyone saved? Now some say yes, to say no there, right? That a universalist at this point is going to say, yeah, see, it's easy. God wants everyone to be saved. He has the power to do it, so he saves everyone. But an Arminian is not going to say that. An Arminian is going to say everyone isn't saved. We agree with that. Everyone isn't saved because God, although sovereign, don't say Arminians don't believe in the sovereignty of God. They absolutely do. They believe God is in control of the world. What they don't believe, or what they do believe, is that God, there's some things God can't do. Everyone isn't saved because God, although sovereign, cannot cause a choice in libertarian free people. You're like, what? All right. So so we're getting into questions about free will. What is the nature of human beings? What are you able to choose? A libertarian, somebody who believes in libertarian freedom. So the question that we're trying to answer here is, what kind of free will do people have? All right, so because a lot of people will raise the question here, what about free will? An Arminian's going to say, everyone's got libertarian freedom. A Calvinist is going to say, no, everybody's got compatibilist freedom. Billist freedom. What do they mean? Well, libertarian freedom means you always have the freedom to do the other. That true freedom, the only kind of freedom that you can be held responsible for, is when you have the freedom to do something other. Like that, it's an actual open option to you. So you're free if I don't pin you down, and you get to make a choice to do something else. So morally speaking, if I say to you, don't punch that person, and you're like, but I'm forced to do it because of my DNA and everything like that, they would say, no, you're not. You don't have libertarian freedom. You need to have the freedom to do the other. The way I usually try to do this is I try to say, look, in libertarian freedom, Jose, my brother right here, we met earlier, picking on you, brother. You just showed up. You're like, what in the world is this going on? Jose, he's a happy dude. And Jose has this bubble around him. A libertarian free bubble. Meaning that Jose can be influenced by all sorts of things. These are all influences. But none of those influences can be causal. So Jose right now is trying to think whether or not he wants to jump up here and punch me. I hope that's not true, brother, but if it is, it's fine. So Jose is thinking, am I going to go up there and I'm going to punch him? They might be a bunch of forces acting on him, influencing him, right? He might have known a guy who looked like me who just wanted to punch his face for a long time. He might not like pastors. He might not like our building. There's a whole bunch of things that have gone on in his life that serve as influences that are pushing him perhaps in that direction. But none of those factors can be causal. A libertarian basically says none of those factors, none of those influences can become causes. Because the moment this influence becomes a cause, he's not responsible for doing it. This cause is responsible for doing it. Yes? And you can't hold him morally, what we call culpable. You can't hold him morally responsible for his actions. Hey, man, I was just forced to do it. So look, if you're going to have any freedom at all, according to an Arminian, it has to be this kind of freedom. Because God will not hold somebody responsible who has a causal factor in their decision. If God causes you to do any particular thing, he will not hold you responsible. The rules are, in other words, that he doesn't reach into this bubble. You guys remember the movie Almighty? What's his name? Bruce Almighty. You guys, we're old enough, a lot of us. Some of you younger are going, what? There's this story about how Jim Carrey becomes God, and he can do all sorts of things, right? He can make the moon closer. He can make his girlfriend look better. He can do all those things. But the one thing he can't do, he's standing outside, and what he wants more than anything else is for his girlfriend to love him. And so he uses all his power of God, and he says, love me! And she just turns away and walks. This is a great example of what an Arminian believes. That she is, he can manipulate the whole world and all the inanimate objects, but if he manipulates her choice, he's broken the rules. So this is something God can't do. He cannot hold someone responsible to whom he has caused their free choice. You follow this? I know it's philosophy. So that's what I mean when I said everyone isn't saved, because God, although sovereign, cannot cause a choice in libertarian free people. So the third one on my little list there, even though people are born dead in their trespasses, Arminian is absolutely in agreement that people are born, and when they're born, they're born in sin. They're born dead in their trespasses. They're incapable of making a choice for God. They're slaves to unrighteousness. And their wills are twisted by sin. In other words, they're totally depraved. Good Arminians actually believe in total depravity means that sin has touched every part of you. There's not any part of you, whether it's your flesh or your desires or your mind or your whatever. There's nothing that sin hasn't touched. Even though people are born dead in their trespasses, slaves of unrighteousness, and their wills are twisted by sin, God acts in prevenient grace, which I'll explain in a second, to provide them a free choice for or against him. So here's my picture. So I'm going to make this line, and I brought this up last week. This is the line of freedom. And by that, I mean above the line, you are totally free. There are no factors acting on you in any way to cause or influence you to make a choice, one way or another, okay? Adam and Eve would have been here, agreed? Are we, when we're born, are we? Well, the answer is no, because we're born in sin. And sin has this way of twisting our will such that our chooser is broken. So my favorite illustration to this is, many have probably heard it before if you spend any time around me, you got 10 brownies in front of you, and there's a 10th brownie is made out of dog poo. All of them are made out of dog poo except the one brownie. How are you gonna determine? You have to eat one. How are you gonna determine the non-dog poo brownie? My favorite thing is a lot of classes I teach on this, one of the first things people say is, taste it? Okay, hold on. No, smell it first, right? Please, please? You want to smell it. What if you got COVID? What if your smeller's busted? How are you going to make this decision? And the answer is, you don't have the faculties to make it. So I'm giving you a decision that you... I don't know, dumb luck is what's going to happen. You're probably going to be eating poo here. Right, this is a good illustration to basically what happens when people are in sin, is that sin has had an effect on every part of you so that it twists your wanter. It twists your chooser. So that even if I gave you a choice, you'd be like, I do not have the capacity to make a choice here. I don't have what's necessary. What I need is someone to, you know, pass me the Paxlovid or whatever the stuff is that's supposed to heal COVID. What I need is somebody to give me my smeller back so that I'm able to make this decision. So this is what I'm saying. Okay, so you're below this line. You have sin affecting. You remember this? Sin is influencing all sorts of things, but you're in sin. What God does, according to Arminian, is he reaches in and he lifts you up. This is what's called prevenient grace. This move of lifting everybody up to a point where they're able to make a free, libertarian free decision for God. God does this, according to an Arminian, for everyone on the whole planet. He basically lifts everyone up at some point, usually it would say when the gospel is preached to them, and he lifts them up through the proclamation of the gospel above this line and then says, go. Do you want Jesus? Or in other words, he's brought you up to the part where you are now above the line and you're like Adam and Eve and you get to choose. Whatever choice you make, God knows before the foundations of the world which ones you would when he lifts you up in this prevenient grace way. And based upon what he sees before the foundations of the world, he will elect. Does that make sense? Which is the last little line there. Election is based on God's foreknowledge, but defined in an Arminian sense by his foresight. So it's not the knowledge of a person in a relational sense. It's foreknowledge, meaning foresight. God, as an observer, looks down and says, if I do this for Jose, he will choose me. Therefore, I'm choosing him based upon what I see him doing given these set of circumstances. Based upon election is based on God's foreknowledge of his of the choice people will make in response to his prevenient grace. Those who choose God or will choose God are elected by God. So some of the texts there they'll point to is that in 1 Peter 1, it'll talk about, you know, election is based upon the foreknowledge of God. In Romans 8:29, those he foreknew, he also predestined to, right? So their argument is, look, see, foreknowledge precedes all of these things. But foreknowledge is defined by foresight. Do you understand the argument? See how it's fair? See how it's gracious? This is a gracious move on God's part, yes? Is it all of grace? Maybe, sure, kind of. But it's fair. Right, you're the one who gets to make the ultimate decision whether or not you're going to heaven or hell. God is not involved in that. He's only responding to what you would do given his prior acting grace upon you. There's too many of us for me to ask for questions, and the time is running on. So we're going to have a Q&A afterwards. So let me give you a critique then of Arminianism, at least what I've presented. And I'm doing it in the form of questions. Question one, is God's desire for everyone to be saved his only desire? So that covers a couple of things. On the one hand, okay, is it true that the Bible teaches that God wants everyone to be saved? You have to do the work exegetically to try to figure out if those passages say that. If you come to the conclusion that they do, you're still left with a question. And this is the question. Is salvation of people the only thing God wants? Or are there other wants that God has that saving everybody would not allow him to achieve? This should not be hard for people like you and me. I love Oberweis, clearly. I love Oberweis mint chocolate chip. I love Oberweis coconut almond fudge. Good Lord. Like, I love it. I also love that I'm not 300 pounds yet. So what I've got is competing desires. They can't both be done. They can't both be done. There will be moments when I choose to eat the Oberweis and there will be moments that I choose not. It is not hard for you and I to believe that we have desires that sometimes compete against one another. Is it possible that God actually has another desire? I actually would argue pretty strongly that he does. Romans 9:22. What if God, wanting to display his wrath and make his power known, bore with great patience the objects of his wrath, so that he might show his mercy to the objects of his mercy? Well, there's a passage that says that God wants to show his wrath against the objects of his wrath. For me then to come to that passage and say to you, oh, see, this is what God wants, so everyone's getting blasted, you'd say to me, whoa, 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 God wants other things too, right? He wants to save as well. And I'd say, yes, absolutely, that's the case. But it is possible that God has other desires. Second, is it really true that God doesn't cause choices in the Bible? Is his sovereignty limited at all in Scripture? So this is what I would call the Pharaoh challenge. And here's why, because what we were looking at even last week is, what does God do to Pharaoh? And listen, it doesn't matter to me who started the hardening and who didn't start the hardening. The very act of God reaching in to Pharaoh and causing his choices, which is exactly what happens. Pharaoh at one point's like, I'm done, man. I'm ready to give up. And God's like, whoa, whoa, whoa. You wanted 10 rounds. So we're not even round six, dude. Back up. I'm going to strengthen your heart. That move, that strengthening of the heart, is breaking the rule, breaking the Arminian libertarian freedom rules. Based upon that, God should not be holding Pharaoh accountable for what it is that he's choosing in those moments. But does he? He does. Absolutely he does. Which is one of the reasons why, okay, when I was doing my doctorate, Kyle Meeker and I were doing it together, and there were 12 students in our cohort. Six of the students had theological degrees, and six of them had philosophical degrees. The philosophical degree guys were all Arminian, and the theological degree guys were all Calvinist. Because, I'll be honest, if I was really steeped in philosophy, I'd say, yeah, no, it only makes sense if you have libertarian freedom. The problem is the Bible is like, yeah, whatever. Actually, God's going to use the Babylonians, and he's going to harden them, and he's going to have them attack Israel, and then he's going to judge the Babylonians for attacking Israel. He's going to actually harden Hophni and Phinehas's hearts so that they don't repent, so that he can judge them. Well, dude, if you're eliminating repentance from him, that's if you're breaking the rules. You're saying he can't do the other, and then you're holding them responsible for not repenting? Right. So the Pharaoh issue is a challenge. Romans 11, the way that Paul talks about the Jews who were hardened, it's hard. We're hardened so that the Gentiles could come in. Where in the Bible does it really teach prevenient grace? Now, most Arminians are troubled by that because they'd say, well, there's no verses that say that this God does this for everyone. What it does say is that God gives the law to everyone, and therefore, in order for them to actually be legitimately able to respond to the law, God has to do this. So it's an inference. Where in the Bible does it teach that God foreknows everyone? This is going to be something that might be a challenge. Isn't this the word used only to speak of the elect? Guys, I will tell you that if you go through the New Testament and you look for the word foreknown, you have a couple of options to it. One of those options is that, yes, God shows foresight. He knows facts about what's going to happen in the future. Is that the word that we should use to talk about that foresight? Or does foreknown mean something deeper? Like, Israel alone have I known. Adam knew Eve. Doesn't it conveys a relational sense, yes? And the answer is, yeah, it really does. And in the passages where it shows up, those God foreknew, he also predestined, he called, he justified, he glorified. This is a statement about the elect. So from that verse, you can't say, well, God foreknows everyone. No, the verse says that God foreknows those he glorifies. So that word is used of the elect. Same thing in 1 Peter 1. It's a word that's used to describe the elect. Does God foreknow everyone? Not in the relational sense that that word conveys. God has foresight of all things. Everyone agrees with this, yes? God knows the future. Although there's a number of people who, because they've been caught in this particular challenge as Arminians, who've decided to say, actually, yeah, this doesn't work either. They want to get God off the hook from the challenge. Because at the end of the day, what this says, and I think I brought this up last week, what you've got, even if this is true, if God has foresight of the future, and he creates a world where he knows what's going to happen in the future, there might be a billion possible worlds, right? The multiverse. But he's only actualized one. And he's brought that world into creation. There might be a world where my sister is saved. But it's not this world yet. What most Arminians argue is it was a numbers game, basically, for God. He foresaw all the people's choices, given all of this stuff. He couldn't save every single person, and so he chose the world where we got the most saved. But he still chose to create a world where people go to hell. If you're an Arminian, you're stuck with that, just like a Calvinist is. The only way out of this is to say God doesn't know the future, which is what lots and lots of people have done. They call that open theism. And there's lots of theologians now that are arguing that God doesn't know the future. And the reason that they need to hold to that is because all of this is unfair. It's kind of bad if God chose to create a world where people were going to go to hell. Right, so it's very easy for me at this point to do the Calvinist bit. It's the same idea. People are born in sin. They would not say that there's a libertarian freedom around them. God has every right to cause choices. In fact, they would say, man, your whole life is caused. You have DNA. You have all sorts of things going on inside of you. If the best salesman could get you to buy a Buick today, which they probably could. You're like, Buick? No, try again. No, they probably could. It's quite likely that God has the ability to sway you in a causal type of way. And the Bible, sir, seems to say that God does this to people. He actually causes it. In fact, when it talks about, you know, Lydia, he opened her heart that she might believe. That those words shouldn't happen. So what God does then is he does raise people up to that level. And then while they're up here and they get new seers, little eyes to see, the people God raises up, they all come to faith in Christ. No one comes to the Father, but the Father, draw him and I will raise him up on the last day. Just think about it. No one comes to the Father unless the Father draws him, and I will raise him up on the last day. Meaning that the same person who they got drawn is the same person who's going to see the Father on the last day, right? They go together. So this is where you get language around Calvinism about unconditional election, which is this move, irresistible grace, meaning that it's unresisted. People don't turn away from it. And the argument of Calvinists is that this is the way the Bible talks about it. And it's the only argument, the only way of viewing it if you really want it to be all of grace. What are the problems with it? Well, why would God create a world where he would save only some? Which I said before is a problem for Arminianism as well. But for Calvinism, it sure is. You're basically saying that God chose this particular way. If God can save whomever he likes, why didn't he save all? How can God be totally in control of the world and still have so much evil around or let people go to hell? Doesn't this impugn his character? Doesn't this make him less than loving? So Calvin's going to say, yeah, that God actually is fully in control of the world and he's permitted this level of evil. The Holocaust? What are you talking about? How are we in any way free to make choices if this is the case? What is the point in prayer and preaching if God has already determined everything? Like, if you're gonna come to faith because God determined it, and why in the world am I preaching to you? I'm wasting my time. So I give all of that to you so that you see that there exist, after you come to understand the doctrines, there exist these kind of thorny questions afterwards that there are answers to from each proponent of each side. I'm a Calvinist because I actually think the answers to this, first of all, I think the Bible argues more coherently for that view. And ultimately, I think there are answers to the questions that I just raised that make a lot of sense biblically. But you get to make the choice yourself. And I'm not worried about it because if God wants you to be a Calvinist, you will.